and never let anybody say, well, you can't make it, cause a feeble mind is in your way. No more tears to regret, and we have finally dried our eyes.
Good afternoon. This is Kaleem Shabazz, president of the Atlantic City branch of the NAACP, welcoming you to our October 6th edition of your NAACP speech. And as the song said, we are a winner. That's our theme going into the November 3rd election. We are a winner. But before we start our opening statements, we want to say that the Atlantic City NAACP, the officers and members, executive committee are in prayer for the full and complete recovery of President Donald J. Trump, his wife, and all of the recently infected persons. And that is our sincere hope and prayer for the president and his family and all of those many people who are affected. That number seems to be growing by day, which leads us to our regular acknowledgement that we do, unfortunately, every week. To all those people who have passed away to COVID-19, over 16,000 here in our state and over 210,000 in our great country. And we mourn for each and every life and we pray for the strength of their families, and we honor the memory of all those who have passed away. We salute, as always, our leader here, WHE President and Leader Elder William Hawks, and our superior engineering staff. The NAACP Speaks program is heard every Tuesday from 4:30 to 5:30 here on WEHA 88.7 and 100.3. Let me report to you, Yolanda, and our audience that the summer membership drive has ended, and I can report that we exceeded our goal. We set a goal of 50 new members. We went way over that, and the renewals were equally as high, people who renewed their membership. So we want to thank everyone who renewed their membership. We want to thank all of our new members. We need you. There's work to be done. And we hope that you will find that your membership is worth it, and that you find our activities, which we will report on to you and keep you informed of what the NAACP is doing. Again, we thank all of you. We thank each and every person who joined as a new member or who renewed their membership. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Mandy Days Chapman, as we had said before, she was leading for a long, long time. She is the individual membership winner, and we thank her. She's an outstanding member of our executive committee. She's the newly installed vice president of Lang City High School, and she's the hardworking chairman of our infant and maternal task force in the NAACP. So she is our winner, and we thank her. Our cluster membership solicitors, which was a more 10 or more, President Hawks, India Steele, Marcus Wilson, and Monica McQueen. And we thank each one of them for their support and their gathering multiple memberships. Flu season is almost upon us, and let us just make this announcement. We'll talk more about this with our special guest. The Atlantic City HealthPlex is now giving out free flu shots from 8 in the morning to 4 p.m. without an appointment. The HealthPlex is located at 1400 Atlantic Avenue. So that's free flu shots. You don't need an appointment. show up, and please, if you have not got your flu shot, please get your flu shot. Encourage your friends and your neighbors, your coworkers to get a flu shot. That's at the HealthPlex in Atlantic City, 1400 Atlantic Avenue, from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. And as I said, our guest today will talk more about that. He is Dr. Wilson Washington Jr., the newly installed Director of Health and Human Services in Atlantic City. Also, let me report to you the mail-in ballots, as we talked about week before last with the county clerk, have been arriving. Most of them have been delivered. I know in Atlantic City and across other places in the county, there's a mailbox. In fact, I put my ballot in the mail this morning. It's located between City Hall and Atlantic County Office Building. Between City Hall and Atlantic County Office Building, please, ma'am, and please, sir, fill out your ballot and drop it there. It is monitored 24 hours a day. It is locked. It is secure. And the Board of Elections, they collect the ballots out of there every day. Last announcement before I turn it over to Yolanda. There's a winter clothing drive that's taking place now. We all know that the winter season is coming upon us. Many people in our community are hurting and need coats. The winter clothing drive is taking place at Turning Point, which is 1717 Bishop Richard Allen Avenue. And they are asking that if you have new or gently new used coats, please bring it there from 9 a.m. to 5, Mondays through Saturday. For further information, call 609-246-6080. 609-246-6080. So if you have a coat, a jacket that is in good condition that you would wear, but for some reason you have an extra one, please take it to Turning Point, 1717 Bishop Richard Allen, and be a blessing to someone who needs it. Having said that, I will turn it over to our very brilliant and efficient co-host and program director and boss of the NAACP program, and also leader of the National Next Gen program. And we're so proud of her in Atlantic City. She is not only a local starlet, she is a national civil rights starlet, and we are proud of her. Yolanda Melville, Esquire.
Thank you very much, President, and I'm honored to work with you. I know many times we talk about this, but the importance of having intergenerational relationships and teaching each other. So over this election season, I've learned a lot about leadership, learned about political activism, and I thank you for that. And you've been imparting us in Next Gen, Constance, myself, Nastasia, Corey, and members of our Next Gen Atlantic City branch have been singing your praises around the country on how honored we are to work with you.
Thank you.
I would be remiss to not mention that you have a pin on you for National Breast Cancer Awareness Month. So we want to make sure we hold that up. And for those who have been survivors of breast cancer or who are going through breast cancer at the time, we lift you up, we lift your families up, and we will keep you in prayer this month and all through the year.
Thank you, Yolanda. Let me just say really quickly, my sister-in-law passed away from breast cancer. So it has a breast cancer has a particular relevance and place in my heart. I also have on my pink tie and matching handkerchief that I'm going to wear throughout the month, and my pin, because breast cancer is something that we need to be very attuned to.
That's right. It does affect our communities a lot.
Yes.
So I don't know the statistics, but I'm sure we can get into that over the course of the month on how breast cancer awareness is so important to the African-American community. You mentioned ballots, and you've already mailed yours. I have not mailed mine.
So oh, here my it goodness. Is.
And I want to show the public who are going to watch us on Zoom later on that there are candidates. Oh, I don't know if you can see it, but the candidates are in the front, and there are public questions on the back. So please make sure you turn it over and you vote on both sides. It does say vote on both sides, but I want to make sure everybody remembers that. And use a blue or a black pen to fill out your ballot. And the ways you can vote are as follows. You can actually go mail it in your mailbox. You can drop it in the drop box, as President Shabazz has said, or you can actually take it on voting election day, which is November 3rd, between the hours of 6 a.m. and 8 p.m. But make sure you do that. If you send it in the post, if the post office box is your option to vote, please make sure you mail it early, because it has to be postmarked no later than 8 p.m. on election day, November 3rd. So my personal choice is that drop box that you mentioned that has the 24-hour surveillance and will be picked up regularly by the superintendent of elections office. I believe we have the mayor on, and it's his time, so I don't want to overstep. But I will say this before the mayor comes on. Please wish Dr. Small a very happy birthday from all
of us. Oh, of course. Dr. Small. Mayor, good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, Kaleem, Yolanda, and good afternoon to your NAACP listening audience. And it's a great day here in the city of Atlantic City, and it's an even greater day as my wife turns her Obama year.
That's funny. Please tell her that we wish her a very, very happy birthday and many more happy, peaceful, productive years.
She said, thank you guys for the well wishes. And, you know, she really appreciates it from the bottom of her heart.
Okay, go ahead, Mayor. What do you have this week?
Oh, well, this week I wanted to let the public know again that as of Monday, City Hall and the city buildings are open, you know, for service. We thank the public for bearing with us on these trying times. We were out since March, and, you know, we're back Monday through Thursday, you know, 4 hours, you know, 8:30 to 4, they can access City Hall. And, you know, we welcomed them back. The line was, you know, halfway to the courtyard when we came in the other day. So we're glad to continue to provide the taxpayer services this time face-to-face. Special kudos to CRDA, who assisted us with the plexiglass shields in all offices at no cost to the taxpayers of the great city of Atlantic City. So we definitely appreciate that. The building has been retrofitted to be COVID, you know, COVID, excuse me, to, you know, remind the people, you know, that, you know, social distance, to wear their masks. Hopefully by sometime next week, the city of Atlantic City, you know, has stepped up in the technological world, as we will have the thermal scans. When you come up to the screens, it'll say, it's a great day here in the city of Atlantic City. It'll check your temperature. Right now, we use our employees to check the temperature. It will automatically check your temperature. If you're fine, you get to go through. If not, you know, there's something that we can have the doors automatically locked and messages go to human resources and other areas. And also, we're going to marry it to our payroll system, PrimePoint, and that's how people are going to sign in and out. And as we need, we'll continue to revamp that technology, but we're purchasing a few of them. They're going to be at several city buildings, and you know, we look forward to that, because who knows, this pandemic is far from over, as you see, and now it's reaching the White House and other you know, branches of the federal government. So we're just happy to have that type of technology here, and we wanted the people to know that City Hall and other buildings will be open Monday through Thursday, and we will be closed on Friday, and employees will work from home. I would like to thank our first responders, which is police, fire, and public works. While people were working from home, these men and women worked daily, very hard, you know, in the pandemic from the beginning, you know, to the end. And I want to publicly thank them on the radio and tell them, job well done. That's why our workers and everyone else continue to make it a great day here in the city of Atlantic City. And I just wanted the public to know, as you know, I just got my ballot in the mail today. Election season is upon us. As a matter of fact, I will be appearing next Monday on the NAACP candidates forum. You have important elections from the top all the way down to the bottom. As they say, all politics are local. You know, you have the mayor of Atlantic City race. You have a very important school board election, amongst others. And I'm encouraging everyone who supports me to vote column B. And for the school board, vote for Walter Johnson, Jared Barnes, and Pat Bailey.
Thank you, Mayor. We appreciate, as always, your section. I was in our barbershop, and a couple of the people said that they heard you and that you sounded good, and they appreciate your update. So we thank you. It's good to see the City Hall back open, and I join you in saluting those first responders, the police, the fire, and public works. They did an excellent job under very trying circumstances. Despite what the president says, this virus is something to be taken seriously, and I salute them along with you. They've done an excellent job, and we thank all.
Well, Councilman Shabazz, before I go, I would be remiss if I didn't let you know personally, when I talked to you the other day, as I predicted, the rumors of the Philadelphia Eagles' demise is greatly exaggerated. So I told you what we were going to do, that we were going to go out to San Francisco. We were going to win big. And listen, I was an athlete. I know what Carson Wentz is going through. There was times mentally I couldn't even make a layup in the game. You know, it's just a funk that you get in, but it just takes games like that, a gutsy performance, to back it out. And through it all the doomsday naysayers, through it all, if the playoffs were to end today, the Philadelphia Eagles would be in first place with a home game in South Philadelphia at Lincoln Financial Field, representing for Eagles fans everywhere. So I say that to say, it's not how you start, it's how you finish. And as I told people, the NFL season is a marathon, it's not a sprint. So for all those Eagle fans out there, Bird Gang, fly Eagles fly on the road to victory.
Thank you, Mayor, for that. The mayor is the biggest Eagle fan in Atlantic County, and he is loyal. We appreciate that. You're right. You did say that. You told me that. He said, Councilman, he said, the Eagles are going to win on Sunday. I said, you sure, Mayor? He said, Councilman, count on it. And he was right. So we appreciate the mayor for his loyalty to the Eagles, and more than that, for his loyalty to the city of Atlantic City and making sure that people vote. We encourage people, as the mayor said, to vote. We don't say the column B on the NAACP. The NAACP is nonpartisan. The mayor is our mayor. He is on column B. Look at your ballot, vote your ballot, and please turn your ballot in. Thank you, Mayor. Congratulations and happy birthday to Dr. Small, who is also our member in the NAACP along with the mayor. And we thank both of them for the jobs they do in public service. Yolanda, I think we have another guest today.
Yes, we have a full house today. So I would like to introduce our next guest, who has been traveling virtually for us here at the NAACP, and we'll be doing a great event on behalf of the NAACP Next Gen nationally with a co-sister branch, the Mid-Manhattan branch. I would like to introduce everyone to I Am Young Hitta, Keyshawn Wyman. Welcome to the show, Keyshawn.
Hello, thanks for having me. It's an honor to be here, as always. Yeah. It's a pleasure to have partnered with you guys at NAACP for a good cause and ongoing. You know, a lot of times people get together just for a one-off. It's a pleasure to be able to get together and do something on an ongoing basis.
Thank you. We appreciate you. Can you tell the audience that it was me that taught you your DJ skills? That's a joke.
that'd have been cool, right?
Yeah. We appreciate you. You are a young man that has his head on right and is focused in the community. And let me just say publicly, the NAACP appreciates your efforts. We appreciate the activities that you've done before, and we want to have a long-term partnership with you to do good works. Thank you so much for what you do.
No problem. It's a pleasure. It's just I find in my heart, you know, it fills my heart to continue this journey across the board. This is something I'm passionate about with the NAACP and beyond, you know. So thank you.
Okay. I am Young Hitta. You've had a busy week, or we'll be having a busy week. So last week we started here in Atlantic City. Right. Now we're moving throughout New Jersey for the New Jersey State Convention the following week. But in between, you'll be doing something special for us at the National Next Gen program. Can you tell us a little bit about what you've been doing and how my sister, Constance Days Chapman, and Next Gen fellow Next Gen 2020 member and my guest always, as she's always on the show, helped you kind of align with us over the last week.
Sure. So, Ms. Constance, I actually worked with Ms. Constance with Pleasantville High School. So I was actually the prom DJ for several schools, but I've been locked in Pleasantville for about 6 to 7 years now. So we had a professional relationship established from her previous employment at the Pleasantville High School. So working together there, we just kind of always kept that bond going, keeping that relationship going. So it was crazy that I actually had changed my number and she was reaching out to me. And I ran into her at a football game, football practice, and I seen her. She's like, I've been calling you. I'm like, you ain't been calling me. Come to find out she had the wrong number. So we changed contact. She was like, she already had a list for me because she was already reaching out to me already. So by the time she got to me, she already had a whole bunch of things lined up. So we jumped on it. We put it together, and I think the first one was a success, and we're on an uproar from there.
So you've been working with us on a few things.
Right.
Making sure young people are active in social justice movements with the NAACP, but also increasing the visibility of voter mobilization and what we can do to encourage young people to vote and people who are not eligible to vote yet, encouraging them that they encourage their family members, their friends, and those who can vote because they're 18 or older. Tell us about why it's so important to really coalesce on this. Social justice, the importance of voting, but also the importance of reaching our youth.
I mean, the importance of it all is that, you know, people have to know where they stand in life and their purpose in life. A lot of youth gets misled by what they see and what they hear. So they know they never really take the time to research themselves to see if it's actually official or not. A lot of them are relying on social media to find the answers. So the thing is, if you're not on social media, you probably won't get the message out. So as far as I'm concerned, I have a following, you know, on and off of social media, but a lot of them are youth because I am DJing for the prom and different things like that. They see my face all the time. So a lot of times when you see someone that they respect, it may be more susceptible to actually listen and take heed to what's being said. A lot of them think they don't have a voice because a lot of times they talk to adults and they may say, oh boy or girl, get out of here. But when they actually stand for something and they see it work, they become a believer then. So I just want to be that advocate to show them that it is real. They do have a voice. And it's essential that we get this word out there because a lot of it is getting the word out there. Some people just don't know, you know, so being able to spread the word across the board, you know, one person tells the next person, this person, that person, we need to attack it from all angles, print, media, social media, all angles, because everyone's on a different type of level when it comes to actual social media. Not everybody's on social media, but that's the goal.
So you're doing a little something special for us on Wednesday, which is tomorrow. So tell us about what you're doing.
So tomorrow is going to be a virtual vice presidential. We're going to be doing a pre-party prior to it. So I believe the time, I'm going to pull a flyer up here. I don't think I have it in front of me. Just pull it up here so that way I'm giving you guys accurate information. it's going to be a virtual watch party, the vice presidential debate. This is going to start at 7 p.m. Central Time and 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'm actually going to do the pre-party prior to it, so it's going to be an hour before, and then we're actually going to show the debate. So we actually be able to watch the debate via Facebook. You don't have to have a Facebook to actually watch it. So you can actually just click the link and be able to watch everything that's going on, and we plan to keep everyone engaged throughout the whole event. So that's the ultimate goal, you know, for people to be able to come on and actually see what's going on from a different angle, a different platform, where it's something enjoyable. You know, a lot of times we see something, CNN, or we see news, and we just turn it because we don't hear so much bad news, we don't want to hear anything else. So when we watch it from a different platform, I think people will be more susceptible to watch it because everyone on the youth in youth is online. You know, so that's the goal to attack the people that are online so they can actually get the right information that they probably wouldn't be searching for in the first place.
Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you for spending your time. President, do you have anything else to say before we wrap up?
No, I just want to say thank you. We appreciate you. And keep on keeping on.
Absolutely. It's a pleasure. Thanks for having me. And I know it doesn't start here. We're just getting started. So just look out for new ideas and new things that we're going to be doing as a team.
Okay.
Thank you. Looking forward to it. That was I Am Young Hitta, Keyshawn Wyman, and we are looking forward to our continued partnership with the Next Gen program and the NAACP.
Take care.
Take it easy, bro. Yolanda, before we go into our 5 o'clock hour, let me also say that in addition to Breast Cancer Awareness Month, this is also Domestic Violence Awareness Month, which is a big issue in this country, a big issue in our community, not talked about enough in our community. In fact, it's going to be almost time to have Sister Deborah back to bring us up to date on what they are doing in her organization in the area of domestic violence. So I just wanted to say that Breast Cancer Awareness Month for the month of October, Domestic Violence Awareness Month for the month of October. I think it's 5 o'clock now. Our guest should be here. And our guest, and this is our joint guest. This is because as everyone knows, Yolanda and I have a friendly contest to see about the guest, but I am constantly outmaneuvered. So this guest for the first program in October is a joint guest, Dr. Wilson Washington Jr., who is the newly installed Director of Health and Human Services for the great city of Atlantic City. And we welcome him. And Yolanda, you are going to, do, as we normally do his bio.
That's right. So let me get your bio, Dr. Washington, and we'll get to the first question. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Dr. Wilson James Washington Jr. is the new director of the Department of Health and Human Services for the city of Atlantic City. Dr. Washington joined the mayor's team at the great city of Atlantic City on July 13, 2020. He earned his Doctor of Philosophy, PhD, in public health, magna cum laude, from Walden University in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Dr. Washington is a healthcare executive and public health professional with over 30 years of leadership experience in the healthcare industry. His motto for the Atlantic City Department of Health and Human Services is, quote, building a healthy and safe community, close quote. He has served as the chief executive officer of the Consumer and Business Education Initiative in Gaithersburg, Maryland, a senior public health advisor for the Federal Department of Health and Human Services, Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration in Rockville, Maryland, chief executive officer for the Regional Health Authority, Richmond Behavioral Health in Richmond, Virginia, and vice president of the Community Health of South Florida, a large federally qualified community health center, and assistant director of institutional medicine for the University of Mississippi Medical Center in Jackson, Mississippi. Dr. Washington is also a retired United States Naval officer with over 24 years of honorable service, retired as a lieutenant commander for the Medical Services Corps. He received a Master of Science with honors from the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California, a Bachelor of Business Administration from the University of Mississippi, also known as Ole Miss, in Oxford, Mississippi, and an Associate of Science in Computer Science from the University of South Carolina in Beaufort, South Carolina. Welcome, esteemed Dr. Washington. Before we get started, I want to say I've lived in many of the places that you've lived, including Richmond and Rockville, Maryland. So we may have crossed each other over time.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's absolutely awesome. I want to say, first of all, to Brother Shabab and to Sister Yolanda Melville, it's a great day in the city of Atlantic City.
Yes, sir.
The mayor liked to make sure that we all introduce ourselves that way, and I think it's an exceptional way to get started. I want to say, first of all, a shout out to our city's first lady, Dr. Smalls, Mayor Marta Smalls' wife. And we wish you a happy birthday. I'm sure that the mayor has great plans for you this evening. So I'm looking forward to this opportunity to provide some information of value to the listeners today.
Okay. Yolanda, you want to take the first question?
Sure. So our first question to all of our guests is, tell us three things about you.
Wow, that's hard. It's very hard to come up with three things. Only three? Well, I'll start out by saying, just like the mayor, I am a diehard Eagles fan.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm older than the mayor, so I was actually an Eagles fan perhaps longer, a little longer, because I've been an Eagles fan for a long time, since high school. And I've won with them, and I've failed with them. And I actually went through the Super Bowl with them. So I do have my Super Bowl ring. So I'm a diehard Eagles fan. As mentioned earlier, I'm a retired Naval Officer, Medical Service Corps, and I'm now your new Director for Health and Human Services, and I'm delighted to be here in this great city of Atlantic City.
Okay. Dr. Watson, let me ask you this. The Atlantic City branch, NAACP, as you know, has an infant and maternal mortality task force that we have been working with for really over a year now. In your position, how do you plan to interact with this task force, and how important is this as a public health issue, this meaning infant and maternal mortality?
Well, that's a great question, Brother Shabab, and I certainly appreciate you asking it, because it's an area of interest for me. It's near and dear to me, certainly because I'm an African-American male, and I come from an African-American mother. Mm-hmm. And the loss of any African-American baby or mother is a significant loss to our community. So one of the things that make it even more relevant for me as an issue or a priority issue for the city of Atlantic City is the fact that the great Lieutenant Governor Sheila Oliver has certainly appointed me to a subcommittee for public health and wellness for the city of Atlantic City. The blessing of the mayor of our great city and the business administrator and our chief of staff, Ms. Kimley Holmes, for the state of New Jersey. And within that subcommittee, we're made up of members from the community, from the city council, from Atlantic Care, the FQHC in the community. And it was interesting that one of our top priorities is infant and maternal mortality with a specific focus on African-American female and babies. Mm-hmm. And so with the NAACP task force, I was very delighted to know that that's one of the top priorities for the NAACP. So in essence, is a perfect marriage, perfect synergy between the City of Atlantic City Department of Health and Human Services and the NAACP. It is going to take a joint effort for us to make an impact on this, I call it a challenge. Some people call it a problem that plagues our African-American community. We know how significant it is. I'm familiar with the numbers. For example, the number of deaths per 1,000 live births of African-American children is 21, somewhere between 21 to 21.5, which is too high, because the state target and the national targets are way lower than that. And we hope over the next 24 to 48 months to help put procedures and policies in place to help reduce that rate down to the 19s and even lower if we can. There are some things that our community needs to know that actually drives this problem. And certainly I think these are things that we can actually get in front of. Things like the age of the mother, the socioeconomic status of the mother, things like smoking, smoking and substance use or misuse, including alcohol, can have a tremendous impact on the unborn fetus, poor maternal nutrition, or even obesity, which is a problem that's germane to our race. I remember Brother Shabab talked about Domestic Violence Month. Right. Domestic violence is one of the indicators that certainly play as a factor in the infant mortality in our race. Other things are like mental illness and mental health and stress. Stress is a big factor. And even problematic pregnancies, if one of our mothers have had problems in the past, it's a mother that our obstetricians and OBGYN docs need to pay close attention. These are high-risk pregnancies, and we need doctors that are that understand our community, understand our population, and help us get the appropriate level of access and the appropriate exposure to the right kind of treatment, nutritional treatments that early on in the pregnancy. So we have a real need for greater education in this area. And I think that, and I know that our efforts over the next 24 months will be completely deployed in this space to try to make a significant impact.
Dr. Watson, thank you. And I appreciate your answer, your involvement and your support as a member of the task force. You came in here and you jumped in and you hit the ground running, as the saying goes, and we appreciate you. Let me ask you another question. The pandemic, even though our president said that the pandemic is not that serious, we know in communities of color, it is serious. What is your assessment of the outlook for this community in Atlantic City, community of color, regarding the pandemic?
Again, another great question, Brother Shabab, and I certainly, Shabazz, and I certainly appreciate an opportunity to respond to that question. I'll say it like this. Atlantic City is lucky to have me, because I understand this thing very well.
Yes, sir.
We're trying to put procedures in place to help us. I call it lean into the storm. So our outlook looks very well in the midst of a storm where we didn't get a whole lot of support. Our community, unlike others, we carry a tremendous amount of underlying risk factors that make us susceptible to COVID-19. I call it the kryptonite. COVID-19 is the kryptonite for communities of color, African-American, Hispanics, and Native Americans. It is our kryptonite. And that's because many of us suffers from a low immunity system that's actually driven by risk factors, such as diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, obesity, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, kidney disease, HIV, AIDS, the list goes on and on and on and on of the underlying risk factors that has an inflammatory type of response, and this COVID-19 virus loves it. So it puts us at high risk. One of the things I tell, and I've been telling doctors in the local communities, please make it as a routine to check your patient's immunity level. And that's hydroxy 25 level. It should be 20 or higher. If it's below 20, that means that you're going to be at risk of a significant impact from an exposure to COVID-19. So you need to have your hydroxy 25 level, 25 or higher. And I would recommend in this environment, you need to try to maintain it between 30 and 50, primarily because the hydroxy 25 or immunity level tells us on the medical side how good your body will fight off an encounter with COVID-19. Mm. If it's below 19, that means your body is not going to produce enough of what we call T and B cells to actually fight off an infection. So what we do and what we've done for the staff of the City of Atlantic City, we've talked to them about doing things, natural things they can do to boost their immunity system, like under the CDC guidance, it falls under NPI, non-pharmaceutical interventions. And that's things like vitamin D3, zinc, turmeric, and even vitamin C. That's vitamin D3, zinc, turmeric, and even vitamin C. Those things will help to increase your immunity system. It's done in a safe way. I do recommend you talk to your primary care provider about it. But those things are, those vitamins, actually vitamin D3 should be called a hormone because it matures in the cellular structure of your body, unlike other vitamins that actually your body takes what it needs from your digestive tract and extract the rest. Vitamin D3 can last in the body from 45 to 90 days, depending upon the number of IUs that you're taking. In the meantime, it helps your stem cell respond and react and boost your immune system such that it actually is not going to keep you from getting COVID, but it certainly will help your body fight it off. And I'll close on this by saying, keeping your immune system up, it's almost like keeping a good supply of soldiers. Imagine this, if you had two soldiers to fight your war, you wouldn't do a good job. That's a low immunity system. But if you had 100,000 soldiers fighting your war, you might be fighting a war, but you're probably gonna win. Mm. And so what we do is encourage people to boost their immune system, to wear their mask, and different types of masks, but you certainly need to wear your mask. You need to practice safe social distancing in the public, that's 6 feet or more. And you also need to practice safe and active hygiene, personal hygiene, hand washing, things like that. If we do those things, we can lean into this storm and we can survive it. And the last thing on it, we need to clean in your environments. There are things that you can clean and the things that you can use in your environment that are not so costly. Certainly Lysol is off the shelves and gone. You can't really find it, but there are other things you can use, like a mixture of water and Clorox. Don't drink it. Absolutely, do not drink it.
Don't drink it.
But you certainly can mix it with certain parts per million with water and use it to spray down surfaces and clean the surfaces. You can use alcohol swabs, and alcohol, it's gotta be at least 70% ethanol alcohol, not the Jack Daniels kind. You need ethanol 70% or higher, and other things like chlorine, which is part of the Clorox family, but certainly hydrogen peroxide, believe it or not, you can get some of that hydrogen peroxide in a spray bottle. You can spray that on surfaces. We understand this virus very well. We understand the structure of it, and at every opportunity we have, we'll kill it, and we're cleaning around city buildings and things like that aggressively. The mayor mentioned that the city closes down on Fridays to do kind of a deep clean so that we keep our city employees and also the buildings that the public do come into, we try to keep them as safe as possible. So I see a very good outlook for the city of Atlantic City, for our residents. If we practice all those safe habits, we keep our immunity system boosted up, we'll be able to lean into this storm and we'll be able to survive it.
Listen, Director Washington, I feel like I was back in college. That was a heck of an answer. It was detailed, but it was easy to understand. Let me ask you another question. You know, in the African-American community, the barbershop, in addition to being a place to get your hair cut and your shave and all that, is also a community center, and is also where some of our philosophers who are paid and unpaid and educated and undereducated hold forth. One of our barbershop philosophers in the shop, and the mayor and I go to the same shop, was talking about the flu. And he talked about the conspiracy of the flu and how this, that, and the other. And I said, listen, bro, we need to take the flu shot. Period. We need to take the flu shot, period. And I don't know if it was because I was sitting in a chair, but they knew I was a councilman or what, but he sort of halfway agreed. Can you talk to us? Should people take the flu shot?
Well, you're right on point with all the questions. That's another great question, especially since we're heading into the flu season. Mm-hmm. Let me inform people. You may not know that the coronavirus is the same virus of the flu virus. They're part of the same family. As a matter of fact, COVID-19 is a name given to the pandemic by the World Health Organization at the end of 2019. However, For everyone's information, the coronavirus is part of the virus that the same family of viruses that the flu family is in. Coronavirus version one was a virus we call SARS, severe acute respiratory syndrome. Again, and coronavirus two is just COVID-19. It was given that name because of the end of 2019. So having said that, H1N1 is the version of the flu. It's part of the corona family. It's called, as a matter of fact, it's called corona because of its crown-like shape, and that's why it's called corona. There's a difference between coronavirus 1, which had only two spikes, and coronavirus 2, which is COVID-19, has multiple spikes. They're longer, and they're more contagious. So a long way to answer this, should you take the flu vaccine? The answer is absolutely yes. Primarily because although it's very different from COVID-19, it is part of the family. So the other thing that people need to know is you will see some symptoms very similar in the COVID exposure that you see in the flu. And that's because they're part of the same family, like the low grade temperature, like the sneezing, like the coughing, like the body aches. All those things are pretty common in both illnesses. But there are some telltale signs with COVID-19. One is a low-grade temperature of 100.5 or higher. Second, a loss of the sense of smell and taste. And third, which is critical, difficulty breathing. If those three things line up, although some can, which some scientists and docs would say you could have those kinds of symptoms with the flu, that loss of sense of smell and taste is pretty germane to COVID-19. Mm. So is the shortness of breath. And so when you add that with the low-grade temperature of 100.5 or higher, then you throw in other things like dizziness, like headaches, like sneezing, like dry cough, like lower pain in your lower right and lower lungs, more than likely you have COVID and you should be tested. You should get to your primary care provider or walk into the emergency room. This disease is very contagious. So should you take the flu shot? Absolutely, because you're gonna give yourself the best chance to knock out the flu. Then you know that the second fight is with the potential exposure to COVID. But it's going to give us and equip us with the best opportunity to lean into the storm and fight it and win.
Dr. Washington, thank you. I know some people in the shop are listening. For those who are not, you can also see this interview on NAACP site. So wanted to make sure I appreciate that answer. Yolanda, do you have a question for Dr. Washington?
Well, as you've given us a first-class education on public health,
absolutely.
I wanted to ask you, before you left, what are some other issues that are on your public health agenda for Atlantic City?
Oh, wow. That's a great question, Yolanda, and thank you for it. We have some big plans for the city of Atlantic City. First, we want to reimagine and we want to restructure and grow the health department. The Atlantic County has been doing an exceptional job through what we call an interagency or a integrated services agreement. But we want services in the city of Atlantic City. We want to have a place for people in the city of Atlantic City to be able to come and get some help. So we plan to grow our department. One of the areas of focus, which the mayor and I share the same passion, is with our youth in our youth area. We feel that youth recreation and multicultural services need a booster shot. We need more services in that youth area. So the mayor has put together a project. I certainly support the mayor in that effort. And he's pitched it to the state of New Jersey and they've approved it. So we're gonna be expanding our area of recreation, youth and multicultural services, which includes some of the senior services for our community. We're also looking to expand in areas of the health education, working to get social workers help navigators to help provide services in the city. And we're also working on an effort to address the issue of opioid. We don't need to lose anyone to prescription medications or prescription opioids that may overdose on the opioid. A week or so ago, the state was giving out through the pharmacies naloxone, which is an overdose reversal drug that people were able to get and keep on their body. And police has them, first responders has that drug. So that if we do run into someone that may have overdosed on opioid and we get there in time, we can actually reverse the overdose. But we're focusing on substance abuse as one of our top priority issues. The other top priority issue we're focusing on is homelessness. Atlantic City is a special place, not only to gamble, but for families to come down. But we don't like to see, I don't call them anything other than people that are in despair on our streets. They're in the wrong place at the wrong time for all the wrong reasons. Right. And the jail is not the place for those people. Our mission center provide great services and one of the attractions for homeless people to the city of Atlantic City. So working in collaboration with our community partners, Atlantic Care and others, the county, Atlantic County and all the homeless centers and all of our substance abuse and mental health services agencies, we're taking a hard look at homelessness and we're trying to work to come up with solutions that to address homelessness in our city. And the last thing we're looking at is resource sharing. I know our Lieutenant Governor is right on point with this. He knows that the city of Atlantic City is not getting its fair share of resources. Atlantic City, we have the casinos here in Crata, has been doing an exceptional job helping the community. But we feel that Atlantic City ought to be getting, and when I say Atlantic City, I mean the 08401. I've learned your zip code, by the way.
You got it. You got it.
And so Atlantic City needs to get its fair share of resources. So we're working, and I'm using the opportunity the Lieutenant Governor has given it me through the subcommittee to the larger committee, which is the Atlantic City Recovery Program. We're working through the Public Health and Wellness Subcommittee to highlight those top five priority issues. And infant mortality is on the top, by the way. Maternal and infant mortality is our number one issue, followed by homelessness with the substance abuse and mental health and resource sharing, the fair share of resources. So we're putting those priorities and working them through our committee, developing a specific plan down to the how-to, which includes the funding, and we'll present that to the Lieutenant Governor for consideration. So we have big plans for the City of Atlantic City Department of Health and Human Services.
Dr. Washington, it has been an education in public health. I second Yolanda's motion. We have learned a lot. I've been taking notes. and you're right, Atlantic City is lucky to have you. We're looking forward to continue work. We're going to let you wrap up. We have 5 minutes left. Of that 5 minutes, you have 2 minutes for your final statements and conclusions.
Well, thank you, NAACP, Ms. Yolanda Melville, and Mr. or Councilman Kaleem Shabazz. It's been, I'll say it like I've heard it in the past. It's been a plum pleasing pleasure as well as a privilege to be with you today, to share some of my thoughts about our mission, which is to keep the residents and the employees of the City of Atlantic City healthy and safe. We're gonna do the best job we can to rebuild this department, to bring resources that are necessary and essential to the City of Atlantic City. And we want our residents to be proud of us 24 months from now. My hope is that everyone in Atlantic City will know about the new Department of Health and Human Services that are providing direct services to the residents and all the constituents for the city of Atlantic City. So thank you so much for this opportunity to voice my opinion about public health and wellness for the city of Atlantic City.
Thank you, Dr. Washington. It's been our pleasure. We're going to have you back. The audience doesn't know, I thought you were going to say that you are an author. You wrote a book about the Million Man March, and we want to bring you back to talk about that and some more public health things. Thank you so much. Be safe, and we appreciate you being our guest, taking time out of your busy schedule. And as you say, it's a great day in Atlantic City, and we're looking for great, great things from the Public Health Department. Yolanda, closing remarks?
I want to encourage everyone to vote. Dr. Washington, did you want to say something else before we left?
Oh, I just said thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Washington. One more week to register to vote. You can register to vote online at the New Jersey State Division of Elections.
And that's important. Say that again.
One more week. Tuesday, October 13th is the deadline to register to vote. Again, if you know someone who is no longer incarcerated, he or she is registered eligible to register. And if you are 17 years old, you can register to vote. And please take advantage of mailing your ballot. Please vote for those who are already registered to vote. Please vote in this election. It is far more important than we think that it is right now. And that is grave as it is. So please continue to vote, register to vote. And it's been a pleasure, Dr. Washington. And thank you again, President.
Thank you, Yolanda. Thank you, Dr. Washington. Thank you, Young Hitter. Thank you, Mayor Small. We had a full slate today. I echo Yolanda's sentiments. Register to vote by October 13th, next Tuesday. It's registration deadline. Vote. I echo Michelle Obama's closing arguments. She said that the president is a racist. I hate to report that, but it's truth. We have to vote for our best interests. When we fight, we win. When we fight, we win. See you next week. Everybody be safe. As Dr. Washington said, take your flu shot.
I got some messages.